Throughout the stories of the Christmas season, there are famous villains. Some are not as famous as others. I don't know if you remember all these villains of Christmas. There's Professor Hinkle. Do you remember him? He's the villain on the old Frosty the Snowman cartoon from 1969. He's the one who wanted to steal Frosty's hat. I mentioned him this morning and she was cackling around the house. Apparently she remembers Professor Hinkle. He tried to melt Frosty actually at one point. He was a bad guy. And then there's the abominable snow monster. Do you remember that? The in the old claymation, he's kind of running around. His arms could move. Not much more than that. He was from 1964. I think that was pretty good technology from back then. Of course, the ones that we think of most are the Grinch, who tried to steal Christmas from Whoville, the famous Dr. Seuss story, and then there's Mr. Potter from It's a Wonderful Life, that evil old man who was the bad guy in the story. And then, of course, the worst of all Christmas villains would be Ebenezer Scrooge. He sets the standard for Christmas villains. The Christmas bad guy, all the other bad guys of Christmas are hoping someday to reach the level of Ebenezer Scrooge. He's that bad. But all of these are fiction. The real scary monster, the villain of all villains, the worst of all, is our own selfish heart. In Dr. Seussian tradition, I'm calling the worst villain of Christmas the self-man of self-mass. Christmas is an opportunity for family and warmth and cheer and joy. Self-mass steals that opportunity and replaces it with bitterness and hurt and envy and hatred. Never underestimate the capacity of the human heart to take the things that are best and warp them into things that are worst. We do that. You think about a child who's unhappy with the toy his parents got him. I remember my grandmother got me the worst presents. Horrible. She bought me once a brown corduroy cowboy hat. I've never been a cowboy. I've never had interest in being a cowboy. And I was so ungrateful. I just did not want that hat. I remember my brother and I going back into my bedroom and practicing being excited for when we would open my grandmother's presents. We would just go, yeah, like that, just to practice. Because when I got a yellow, bright yellow sweater, which I'd probably wear today but didn't want to wear back then, I was not very pleased. And you know, that's just selfishness. And then there's the teenager who wants to live the entire Christmas season in isolation from everybody else. Who wants to just, I don't want to talk, don't look at me, I'm going to bend over my back like a noodle, and I just don't want to be seen. And then there's the 20s and 30-somethings who squabble with each other over which family they're going to visit and why I don't like to visit your parents because they're so blah, blah, blah. But then whenever we visit your parents, it's always, and that argument takes place, and it takes place at selfness. And then there are middle-aged people who can be selfish, envying the success of others at the holidays. That's why there's so many blue feelings at Christmas. You see what everybody else has and all that they can provide for their kids and their families, and look at how happy they are, and we're not like that. And then, of course, seniors can be that way at Christmas. Where are my children? I thought they'd be back this year. Why is nobody thinking about me? Selfness is the worst holiday that you can expect. It's that self must stop seeing the incredible grace and giving nature of the season, the meaning of what God did for us, and replaces it with the taking and expecting and the thinking only itself. But that's not how it started. In fact, the first Christmas, the day Jesus was actually born, was not a time of getting, but a time of giving. God gave his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem those that are under the law. Mary and Joseph gave of themselves, God already telling them in advance what would happen, and each of them knew the incredible gift that they would have to give the world. Mary would be forever tarnished, her reputation damaged, so much so that when the Pharisees were talking to Jesus as an adult, they questioned Mary's purity. We know where we're from. We know who our father is. And of course, Joseph, he would marry the woman who would have her reputation tarnished. He was a righteous man, an ethical man, an upstanding man in his community. And even though he had almost nothing of this world's goods, he had his name and reputation, but he would have to give that over to be the human father of Jesus. Christmas is about giving and not getting, more about hoping than expecting, more about thinking of others than thinking of self. Christmas is always better than selfness. So let's consider for life from man's perspective. Selfness makes the most sense. And the reasons are three. Reason one is because the humble are often at the whims of the powerful. You see it beginning in verse 1 through verse 4. It came to pass in those days that Caesar Augustus made a decree to tax the world. And of course then, because of that, every man and woman had to go back to be taxed in their own city. Well, just the men, but the women went with them. Joseph went up out of Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, Bethlehem, because he was from David's house. Octavian was the most powerful ruler of Rome. Here is Gaius Octavius, called Augustus by the Roman Senate in 27 BC. His parents were important people. His father was a Roman senator. He was adopted at age 18 by his great uncle Julius, not Orange Julius, Julius Caesar. Octavian fought with his uncle in Caesar's civil war, fought against Pompey. He famously fought against Mark Antony. You remember Mark Antony? Caesar wrote of him, "Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears." That Mark Antony, who was at the time connected to Cleopatra, the Greek woman who lived in Egypt, and they were defeated at the Battle of Actium in 31 BC. Because of his incredible feats, he was named the Princeps of Rome. He was the first emperor, and in 8 BC, the month Sextilius was renamed Augustus after him. We celebrate, I guess we don't celebrate it, we tolerate. In North Carolina, we barely make it through. August is so hot. But we still have it today. And when he died, Augustus was named by the Roman Senate to be a god. They deified him. Well, Octavian, this powerful ruler of Rome, issued an edict that the empire should be counted for tax purposes, upending what would have been Jesus being born in the poor city of Nazareth and taking him all the way to Bethlehem to be born. It required Joseph and Mary to travel some 70 to 80 miles when she was in her third trimester, and I spent about an hour trying to figure out what that would be like, looking at all the different pregnancy manuals I could find online of what is it, what is exercise can a woman do in her third trimester, and how much is too much, and I came to the conclusion 70 to 80 miles is too much for a pregnant woman. Joseph had to appear in person at the census. The irony here in verse 4 is that Joseph was the rightful king of Israel. He was of the house and lineage of who? Of David. He had right of David's throne. He was in the line of David's house. His family was from David's town of Bethlehem. And here this poor janitor, a carpenter, a fix-it man, that's what he would have been, living an impoverished life in Nazareth, had to pick up himself and his wife, who had not yet married, and traveled 70 to 80 miles to Bethlehem. Their lives were at the whims of the powerful. The second reason why selfless makes sense to man is because the humble are usually experiencing inconvenience because of their lowly station. It says in verse 5, he was to be taxed there with Mary, his espoused wife, who was great with child. And while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Mary chose to be with Joseph at this time, and possibly it was to avoid scandal at home, giving birth now with nobody around her. Maybe, as some suggest, she saw in Jesus the fulfillment of Micah 5:2 and knew that she needed to travel to Bethlehem. Whether that is the case or not, I don't know. During the time she was in Bethlehem, she goes into labor. And all of you who've given birth in a hospital with doctors and anesthesia know what it must have been like. You can imagine what it would have been like for Mary to go into labor in Bethlehem. She knew her situation was problematic, The ancients were well aware of the gestational time frame for ladies, and she knew she was likely to give birth in a very difficult and a hard place. And the travel would have been very difficult because she was very pregnant. And so the poor and the humble often experience inconvenience because of their lowly station. The third reason why selfness makes sense to people is because the lowly, the humble, are forced to make do with what they have to survive. It says in verse 7, she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger because she had no room for them in the inn. Mary gave birth in mean conditions. She wrapped the baby herself. Did you pick that up? She gives birth. There's not a nurse there to whisk the baby away, to do all of the tests to make sure the baby is healthy, and then to wrap the baby and clean the baby for her. No, after giving birth and going through all that entails and all that comes after birth, going through all of that, she then has to take the baby herself and clean the baby and wrap the baby in the swaddling clothes. It's unlikely there were attendants there, and she swaddles Jesus, which is the normal care for a baby at the time. She does it herself. And the inn, the one she was kicked out of that she had no place for, is a traveling house, a place where people would stay when they were traveling. And it's unlikely here the inn is like a hotel, as you would expect. It isn't that she went up to the Embassy Suites and she couldn't get a place there and she had to settle for the Red Roof Inn. That's not what it means here. It means that she had to live now on the bottom floor of the house where all of the animals were kept. Or maybe even outside, if it would, that traveling house did not have a bottom floor for animals, there would have been a cave, as some in the early church suspected, where they would have the animals. And Jesus was born in a place that nobody should be born. And so they arrive in Bethlehem. The house is full of guests, and now they have to be with the animals. And so it's natural that Jesus, after being born, is wrapped in the swaddling clothes, and he's laid right down into the place where the mouths of these animals had just been, eating and munching on the hay. There's no mention of any animals being present, but obviously the manger is there, the place of their food. We assume the animals were there. Can you imagine the stench? Can you imagine the infection that would be possible in a scenario like that? And Luke is trying to tell you something. Ladies and gentlemen, Luke is trying to say, by writing this first section, he wants you to know that Jesus was born to very humble people in very humble place with nothing to his name. And the world looks at that and says, no, that's all wrong. Kings shouldn't be born in stables. Kings shouldn't be laid in mangers. Kings shouldn't be born to impoverished people. Kings shouldn't be born like this. And the whole world rises up like the self-man of self-mass and says, no, I reject this, but understand this is what God determined beforehand for people to understand about his son. He would be born of humble means. And he would be born in a humble place. And this leads us really to God's perspective. Because we find here that Christmas, number two, is always better than self-mass. And there are three reasons here. First, because God uses the humble to bless the world. Look at verse 10 again. The angel, speaking to the shepherds, said to them, "Fear not, for I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." God used Mary and Joseph for a very special mission. Both of them had to give something up for this work. As I mentioned, Mary gives up her reputation. She puts it all on the line for Jesus. Joseph has to accept the special conditions of his marriage to Mary. They were already experiencing the difficulties of accepting this mission, but at the same time, they were already experiencing the blessings of being the earthly parents of the King of Kings. Good tidings of great joy. The sacrifice of Jesus, following the sacrifice of his earthly parents, is the basis of what we call the euangelion. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the gospel. That's the word here. The word good tidings is the word gospel. It should be translated gospel. I bring you the gospel. Jesus is born. It's the gospel. The life and ministry and teachings of Jesus is the basis on which all of us are saved. The humility of his parents and his own humility, it was required for all of us to have eternity in heaven. And their giving then is what brings joy to the world. If you celebrate Christmas and you're excited and you're happy at Christmas because you have family and you can give gifts and you can think about Jesus, all of that is built on this one truth. Jesus was humble. His parents were humble. And they gave you that gift. Without them, you wouldn't have it. There wouldn't be glad tidings of great joy. And all the happy songs we sing at Christmas, all the cherished carols that we sing about angels that we've heard on high, that we listen to the herald angel as he gives the news to the shepherds, all the things we cherish at Christmas, all those carols, they're all built around one central truth, the humility of Jesus and his human parents. Their sacrifice was a blessing to others. And do you realize God was using them? That's the blessing, to know that in your difficulty and in your time of trial, God's using you. That God is actually taking self out of you and replacing it with his giving spirit, and he's using you. And if you're feeling selfish today, understand that whatever difficulty you're facing is an opportunity for you to show the humility of Jesus to others, even as you accept that trial for yourself. The second reason is because they experienced the glory of God. Can you just stop and reflect on verse 12? And then we're going to put contrast to this verse. And this is a sign to you. Here's the sign. The baby is wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Now, we just read earlier that Mary wrapped the baby in the clothes and put him in the manger. The shepherds receive an indication. This is where you will find the glory of God. You will find the glory of God in that place. Mary had already experienced this. She held in her hands the very creator of the world. She looked into the eyes of the one who rules over everything, one who is the head of the church, who holds all things together by the might of his power, the one who would later change water into wine, the one who would heal those who were deaf, the ones who could not walk, he would make them to leap for joy, the one who could raise the dead, the one who could make the blind to see, and the one who would give of himself on a cross and then rise from the dead triumphant over death. She held him in her hands. She saw the glory of God. And while it took humility for her to be there, understand that even as Jesus, it says in Philippians 2, in giving up himself to become man and in giving up himself to become one who would die on a cross, he will be highly exalted and given a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and earth and things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that he's Lord to the glory of God the Father. That is incredible glory for Jesus because he was humble, that Mary and Joseph were exalted by God because they were given a privilege that almost nobody else in the world ever had. Simeon had that privilege. Anna had that privilege. That Mary and Joseph had the most incredible privilege of any person who's ever walked on this earth since Adam walked with Jesus in the garden. They spent time with God. I mean, what do you think Mary's devotions would look like in a modern context? Right? I mean, you know, modern context, we talk about devotions. Did you open your Bible today? Did you spend time with God today? Mary would say, sure, I did. I spent from 9 to noon. We were out in the back garden. I was with God today. It sounds trite, but it's not trite. It's true. She experienced the glory of God. All the brilliance and brightness of the angels. No, it didn't shine on Jesus. And you don't have the baby with the little halo like the painters of the medieval times, the Flemish painters painting the cherub Jesus, the baby Jesus with the little glow above his head. It wasn't like that, no. He didn't have all of those things. He didn't have all the things that we tried, the trappings we tried to make seem like Jesus had. He didn't have any of those things. Human things he didn't have, but he had the things of heaven. And just imagine the fear in their hearts when he stayed behind as a young man to debate the scholars of Israel. Their frustration that they had to travel back to find him. What do you think they must have felt when they walked into the temple and they were talking with Jesus and they find him there disputing with the men who were of great renown, the scholars, maybe Gamaliel himself, teaching him because he's the King of Kings, because he's the author of the Bible, Gamaliel claimed to understand. Reason two, humble people are better. Selfness loses because the humble experience the glory of God. Reason three is because they are blessed themselves for their humility. Verse 19, Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. The humble are able to stop and see what God is doing. When you get caught up in yourself, you can't see what God's doing around you. You can't see all the good things going on in your life. You're just focused on the bad. You're just focused on the negative. You're focused on that one thing. And if that one thing would change, I would be happy now. I'd be okay. You can't see what God's doing. You get so caught up in yourself, you get so focused on what you're doing, you lose the focus on what God is doing. And that's what Mary was able to do. As a humble woman, she was able just to stop and think about all the things that she had been through, seeing the angel, talking to her cousin Elizabeth, then Elizabeth's child being born when in her old age, and then now having been told by the angel what would happen to her, experiencing that pregnancy, you're traveling very pregnant to Bethlehem from Nazareth, and then holding baby Jesus in her hands, the shepherds showing up, claiming that what they had seen of the angels, and of course she believed it because she had seen the angel herself. All of this Mary is experiencing. Mary is able to stop and see this and meditate on it. You see this? She kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. She's able to meditate on the Lord. She can think about the shepherds. She can think about the stable. She can think about the baby Jesus, and she can hear his cries. She can see his face. She can touch his little hands, his little beautiful feet. She can do all of those things, and she can just stop for a moment and realize how blessed she was. At a time when we give gifts, and the world gives incredible gifts, time when people go into deep debt in some cases to buy outrageous presents, trying to earn the love of their family, at a time when all of that is taking place, Mary had nothing for Jesus to give but her love. She had nothing for Jesus to give. No money, no reputation. She had nothing to give. Instead, what she saw there in that moment with that little baby is what God was doing in giving to her. And now she's blessed for it. And that's what humility brings. Men and women, the whole world is trying to encourage us to be proud. It doesn't take much encouragement, does it? It's inherent in all of us. We all want to be better than we are, to take another step up, to have something nicer. But all of the sins that we talked about earlier, the envy and the selfishness that comes with self-mass, all of those sins are so nothing in comparison to what you do receive when you stop for a moment in humility and realize everything that God has given. I know we just came out of the Thanksgiving season, but probably one of the sins of Christmas is that we stop thinking about all that God has given to us. We did that last month. We don't have to do it this month. But this, ladies and gentlemen, is the key to understanding the humility that we're supposed to have. The real humility is to stop in the trial, in the dirt now, and hear the voice of God speaking. And instead of coming back with all of our answers and reasons of why it's life is unfair and things are difficult. We come back and we just, like Job, we put our hands across our mouth and say, I don't even know what I was talking about. Because now we see everything that God has done and everything that God is doing, and we recognize the blessing that we have in Him, that our satisfaction is in Him. You'll never be satisfied, children, with a toy. It lasts a moment. It's fleeting. Half of them break the first day. I think they're all made where McDonald's gets their Happy Meal toys. I mean, that's where they all, you know, same factory. You have it for a day, it breaks, it's gone. All of that anticipation is like a balloon being popped. The joy's gone. You get no satisfaction in those things. You get no satisfaction, ladies and gentlemen, in all of the things of life, in houses, in cars, even in our own health, in our bank accounts. There's no satisfaction in careers. It shouldn't be. We shouldn't even be gaining satisfaction in our spouses. Our true satisfaction is in Christ, is in God. And when we are satisfied in Him, when we have our joys in Him, that is when we realize how blessed we are, how great we have it. No, I don't have it as well as everybody else. I don't have a house as nice as some other people, but I have it better than a lot of other people. I woke up today in a house that was warm. I put my feet down into carpet that was soft, and I walked into a shower that had hot water. And even though I chose not to eat breakfast, I could have. I could have gone to the nicest restaurant in town if I wanted to, if I'd gotten up early enough. I could have done that. I had all these things. But do you know what I have greater than that? I have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I can say, you know what, those things are great, but they're not satisfying. The only thing that I have is satisfying is Him. That's what humble people do. They embrace Jesus. And now you have a choice before you as we conclude. Are you going to celebrate Selfmas this year, or are you going to celebrate Christmas? If you celebrate Selfmas, you'll have a good time for a short period of time. While you're unwrapping those gifts, before you see what's underneath, before you see the yellow sweater, and the brown corduroy cowboy hat. Had to be corduroy too. Ugh. I wish I still had it, actually. I'd probably wear it today, right? It's a legend in our family, that hat. I wish I still had it. You can celebrate Selfmas and be disappointed. Or you can get around your little tree and you can look at all those presents and you can stop and say, do you know what this represents? It doesn't represent my joy in a box. That's not what it represents. It represents the fact that there are people in this world who thought about me and said, I want to think of what could I get this person that I think he or she would like? It's love. And of course, it's just reflecting the greatest love, the love of Jesus at Christmas. Let's not celebrate Selfmas this year. No, let's celebrate the love and joy that comes out of true humility as we embrace our humble Savior. Let's pray. Father,